It's a Wednesday wisdom.
Yeah, America.
I'm Moo Moo.
You can find wisdom wherever you look.
Come, 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 visit my garden. What is a wisdom? My wife.
You're a bunch of losers.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Wednesday Wisdom.
It's pronounced Wednesday Wisdom.
GabSmacked.
Yeah.
Let me do it.
Fine. Go ahead.
Good boy. All right, we're back. So we're going to talk about love and whatever else. And what else are we talking about, GabSmacked?
You wanted to talk.
Yeah, but I don't know what to say.
So, everyone on YouTube and on Periscope, it is a pleasure to see you all. We are back from our thesis cave. And I tell you, there is nothing worse than doing a thesis, except one thing, which is going over a finished thesis. When you have 53 pages plus 10 pages, and that's, hey, true faiths in Bethlehem. Hello, Bethlehem. Bethlehem, house of meat in Arabic, and Bethlehem, house of bread in Aramaic and Hebrew. Good to see you all, everybody. Yeah, checking every single letter, every single part of the equation, checking that the I is smaller than the N, if it's N initial in terms of energy states. Oh, it was just unbelievable. If you think you have attention to detail, believe me, you don't know what detail is until you do something like that. And it can drain your brain. Yes, laham in Arabic is meat, whereas in the other older Aramaic languages is bread. So I guess give us this day our daily bread in Arabic has a different meaning. I guess we know what they lived on in the desert. The other good thing about, of course, the desert, there's some interesting traditions that they have, like in places like Dubai, when I think it's called Kapsa, I'm not sure the exact name, someone from Dubai might know, but it's where they put the meat in the ground, and it's so hot in the desert that it just boils over 10 hours, and you get this braised type of meat, or whatever the type of name is for it, but it comes out like lean, and it just comes right off the bone. So there you go. Give us this day our daily meat, ladies and gentlemen. So, pleasure to see you all. Yes, I do have thesis withdrawals right now, and believe me, it's the type of withdrawal you want. You drop the thesis off, you send it in, and I'm like, ah, somehow I weigh 1 ton lighter. If you want tolerance, come to America. This is what Vincenzo says on Periscope. America, oh yeah. Sage Cryptic, good to see you. So we were talking about Dr. Samira experiencing joy, which I've been able to, first of all, understand what that means. I did a YouTube video on that 2 years ago called Understanding Enjoyment or the Purpose of Enjoyment. And this, for those who are new to YouTube and or Periscope, theory of mind is something that I had to develop consciously. It's sort of like someone who doesn't know the difference between red and green, but can infer the difference. And first of all, has to realize that the world sees them as differently intuitively. Has to understand, hey Sage, good to see you, what that actually means and how to pick that up. Now that's sort of like what theory of mind is when you learn it consciously. You have to figure out what people are saying, when, count how many words they're saying so you know how many words you say in reply. All of these techniques that you learn to develop like an external rule book that you plug in to connect wherever the natural intuition is for the regular human into the theory of mind to get yourself running. Now, for those also who know me, you know that my IQ isn't terribly high, but I have something called savantism, which means that in some specific parts of the brain, I have an unusual set of skills. And one of those is a memory, which I thought was normal, but apparently it's about 1,000 times more intense, which has, of course, its good and bad points, being I remember a lot of bad things. However, what we've come to learn is experiencing joy. And experiencing joy actually, in a way, forms a sense of grief, because it actually reminds you about how much worse your past was than you thought it was. And I was saying to the doc that sometimes I feel as though it was almost better off living in misery, to not know how bad that misery was when compared to the moments of joy that I've now learned to understand. There's also the sense of loss as to what could have been, what could have happened if I knew what I knew as a younger person. You had the same thought when having joy. There you go. I have something in common with a brilliant artist, ladies and gentlemen. But I'm not brilliant and I can't draw. So there you go. For those of you on YouTube that just missed this, the doc said it's actually quite common for those that experience growth to actually experience with that a sense of loss. I guess that's part of what people call growing up or maturity. Mittens the cat, lovely to see you. So there you go. That's actually not something that's unique to the autist. That's actually quite general. feeling sadness and grief in service of self-improvement and self-awareness. But it also makes you appreciate the joy that the innocent still have. So I drive school kids home now, Monday to Friday, and to see them happy over little small things, the fact that I know all their names when they get on the bus, or, you know, a couple of times I brought lollies on, or one of them got, I shot out free Wi-Fi so they could watch some cartoons and stuff, and they were just so happy over that. It makes you so happy and appreciative of what they as of yet cannot appreciate. And it's a, it's sort of, you know, it's it looks like it's vicarious, because you're experiencing, yeah, the kids are pretty awesome. They scream out they love me a lot of the time. Good to see you, great gold, hey. You know every single name? I do know every single name. I started off with nicknames for them, so pronunciation probably wrong. But I've learned their languages too, so like only basic phrases, like, you know, when I found out one person had a look like a Croatian name, and I said, ah, zdravo, kako si, dobro, so just did that, so I'm like, dobođenja, I don't know how to pronounce it properly, obviously. And then you have the couple of Greek ones, which is like, yasas, re, ela, re, pospas, you know, and I think like, I just said the first two things of the Our Father, which is like, I can't remember what it is now, it's like, paterimon, entois uranois, but that's sort of like, ho entois uranois is like classical Greek, and then they say, entis uranis, I think now in modern Greek. And then you got a couple of people, Arabic, were like, ahlan wa sahlan. Yeah, and then I was pumping Chris Brown, and I got in trouble by the teacher, so I stopped pumping Chris Brown. Yeah, it's pretty cool fun. And what else? But now I just pump some clean music now, which is good. And some other trippy stuff that they asked me to play, which is quite weird. But anyway, this is joy that you can experience by living vicariously through the mind of a child. There's a few different comments in there. Popularity breeds contempt. It can breed contempt amongst those who resent the popularity which one has possessed. It also depends upon the means by which one has obtained that popularity. Is it through their own hard work and their own genuine character that other people admire? That can definitely cause resentment. That's the Cain and Abel story, is the archetype of that idea. What was the other thing about people want popularity? It depends why you want it for. If you're seeking popularity, then of course you're not going to find it except for some sort of superficial version. Whereas if it's a side effect of you being who you are, that's a different story. Then you come back to the Cain and Abel part, where you become popular as a side effect of actually being likable. But then I talk about that actually in the later on in the book, on the director's cut, we'll be talking about that when I became a DJ and became really successful, and how it actually wasn't what I didn't want. It wasn't what I wanted. I don't seek popularity personally. Very cool. That's why you're a cryptic, Mr. Sage. Now, relationships are a big deal for me now at age 37, where they should have been, not should have been, but you would expect that they would have been at a much younger age. So part of, with autism, you have something that comes along with it, which is pervasive developmental disorder. And so your personality develops very haphazardly, because especially if you're a high-functioning autistic like myself and you have savantism, so your ability to pass logically is way advanced. So by the age of 6 and 7, you know, people like myself, those ones around, can already do, you know, year 12 mathematics naturally. But they socially function as though they're a 3-year-old. And it takes a long time for that to develop. And the last 7 years have seen a radical development of my EQ, up from about the age of 11, 12 to then 20 to 25. And I'm guessing it's getting past the 25 age now, because I'm starting to focus a lot on relationships and how important they actually are to humanity. Things like going to a funeral or going to a wedding, which is part of the embodiment of human solidarity, what it actually does is it provides the opportunity to connect with people so that you can progress in terms of relationships down the track. So that's something I spoke about in a Wednesday Wisdoms a few weeks ago. Check it out on YouTube. I back up all these on YouTube at GabSmacked, so have a go, have a look. But one of the interesting things that I was able to realize recently, and this is something that most people probably know since they were 15 maybe, there was a valid realization that one cannot have multiple short-term relationships whilst also looking for a long-term committed relationship. You would think that it's more transactional in a sense, hold on, while I am waiting for my main meal to come, I will start with an entree so that I don't starve to death. Well, actually, in real life, it doesn't work that way, because the idea of being in the frame of mind of one who wants to look for a committed reciprocal relationship where you put one first and they put you first, whether it's friendship or more than that, it requires your mind to be free of the distraction of looking for short-term relationships or acting on short-term relationships. It doesn't mean you have to act on it. You don't have to act on it. I'm not assigning any morality to this comment at all. It's just an interesting addition to my theory of mind. And everything with the autist has to be learned logically. Now, there's an advantage to that. And that is that these rules, like facial recognition, conflicting hierarchies, very nice, very nice. This is Vincenzo, everybody on YouTube. I tell you an interesting thing about that. Someone just raised a point saying that most men want to sow their seed in their youth. I don't think the idea of sowing the seed wants to go away, and I don't think it's as real as one thinks it is. It's more because it's harder to obtain. But once, if you're one of the lucky ones who is able to obtain it, all right, good to see you, Sage. Until next time. I need to talk about myself and a few other people, but there was always that desire for different reasons, which I've spoken about previously. One is for the popularity, which someone said. One is to be accepted socially. One is to feel that you're amazing, that you can be attractive. One is because you think you want to sow your seeds. But it turns out once, well, I don't know, in my case anyway, is that the short-term stuff had almost zero benefit. Because when you're sharing something quite, say, unique and intense, to put it that way, frequencies, yes, with someone else, you are wanting to put them first, I would say, in that type of scenario. And hence, I'm not talking about sort of, you know, urges come and Friday nights, etc. And by wanting to do that, it's sort of... Now, you'll have to forgive me on YouTube. My ADHD kicks in pretty quickly when I have a lot of comments coming in now on YouTube, on Periscope. Interesting. Well, that's quite interesting. Someone just said that now they're in their 50s, as a male, they want to now more focus on the relationship. Now, obviously, I'm not in my 50s yet, so you know more than me on that. I'll have to trust your judgment. I can say that I think in my case, I've always wanted a relationship, but I didn't understand that I did so. There was always the desire, the physical desire, which comes first, that idea of short-term escapism. And I can say that that part hasn't gone away anywhere near what I thought when I was 23 that it would. It's probably 97% as much as it was when I was 23. But what happens is that this extra idea of understanding how to value a relationship consciously in terms of what I'm saying right now, and it makes you realize that, yes, it is what you want, and it was always what one wanted. And in my case, for example, could that stem from the lack of dating? In my case, I don't think so, because my dating record in terms of volume apparently is unusually high. And I have spoken about this previously, so I won't get into that here. I did, in my early 20s, I wrote about this in the book. I was dedicating myself to trying to become someone who, say, the opposite sex wanted to go out with. And so I learned to copy mannerisms to an exquisite amount of detail, and I became hyper successful. And there's an interesting thing about that is anything that involves, what's the word, competency. So it requires competency, for example, to be what someone might perceive at the surface to be an eligible bachelor. And the thing about competency is that once you become one of the best at it, you get a very unfair portion of the benefits. And as they say, the lion's share, because the demand flows upwards into that unique area. It's sort of like, well, it is the Pareto distribution, but it's sort of like the most popular nightclub would get more people in it than the bottom 50% of nightclubs. So the most popular of whatever it is gets more than the bottom. Sort of like Tiger Woods is going to, you know, have more, say, objectification of himself via those of the opposite sex and those of the same sex than, say, you know, if he was working at Home Depot, for example. It could make a difference. But I did realize that even today, I've now learned to separate not the quality exactly. I've learned to separate the two. And that's something I couldn't do at 23. I didn't understand that. Now I can understand that, yes, it's like every 5 seconds there's some gorgeous girl, and every fourth or fifth girl is looking at me, and every ninth or tenth girl is waiting for me to ask him out. And it happened even today. And it's so obvious now. I mean, you know that once you've seen it happen multiple times, you see quite clearly when a female starts talking to you on the street and mentions her ex-boyfriend or ex-husband and deliberately goes out of her way to make sure that she's letting you know she's single, and she's trying to make conversation with you when you're trying to walk away, and they're gorgeous and all that stuff. The 23-year-old version of yourself, which still lives in the back of your mind, thinks, yeah, I'm great, I'm awesome. But the irony is that it's not something that you want consciously, and you're actually not interested in that, but you understand that it happens at a biological level. So you know that, yes, they're hot. Yes, they think you're hot. Okay, that's great. Whatever. Good luck to them. I hope they're happy, and you move on. Whereas at 23, that never would have happened. At 23, if someone said you're hot, I'm like, oh my God, he's my number, right? You just sort of lunge at that scenario. And so there is some sort of rite of passage that I've psychologically gone through. Now, that might be different to what that gentleman was saying who's in their 50s. It could be at your 50s you have a much better balance of, say, testosterone and other drugs so that you're able to think completely with the correct mind. So you don't need the level of rationalization that I've put into this as a much, say, when I say younger because I am biologically a lot younger than 37, I would say, and that's partially probably genetic and partially because I exercise every day. And I'm not saying anything about anyone else. It's just something that I learned because I had a sports science diploma at age 19, and I learned about human growth hormones and how to have them naturally be secreted into your body by exercise in certain ways. So whatever, not that big a deal. So the question of whether the relationship is worthwhile does not need to be answered before entering the relationship necessarily. I did not know that. So once again, being the autist, you think yes, no, black, white, discrete movements, you know, forward, backwards. There's no spectrum. There's no gradation of thinking. And so it turns out that actually it's okay to not make a decision that I'm going to be celibate or I'm not going to date, for example. It's maybe better to work on yourself and decide as you meet someone over time whether or not, thank you, Stella, very much, the relationship is going to progress. And sometimes it's decided for you. And I have to say to guys out there, especially anyone like me who's like EQs down the drain, statistically, you're more likely going to be dating someone who is much more emotionally intelligent than you. And then they'll probably know whether the relationship is going to progress or not well before you do. And that might explain why so many divorces are initiated by females, statistically. Now, getting into the next thing we spoke about. Yes, binary and rigid thinking is something definitely that happens with someone on the spectrum. That's guaranteed to happen. In fact, it can make you a great engineer. In my case, a theoretical physicist or a mathematician. It has its advantages. But of course, when it comes to relationships, it becomes very difficult because you start analyzing, oh, yes, I sent 3 texts. Therefore, I have to wait for 3 texts. If they send 1 text, then I can't send another text. Now, you start to do that at a younger age. Now it's much more fluid. So I don't think about it in that level of detail, Captain Cringe. But it does take a lot of work. If you're one of those guys like I am deep down, and you know, like you might be right now on the nerdy side, you're going to feel like it's a mountainous duty and you might want to escape and just become a monk or go sit in the library like I did for God knows how long. Look, it's difficult, but acknowledging that it's difficult is okay. And acknowledging that you're going to make so many mistakes is fine. Be okay with that. That doesn't mean you deliberately want to hurt anyone. Of course not. And looking back, there were people that I unintentionally hurt, which is very sad. But what I can do from that is learn from it to make sure that I don't do that to the next person. So that's the plan. Now, and you'd think I would realize that I was actually thinking binary. No, doesn't happen. Doesn't matter how many times I go onto Wednesday Wisdom, YouTube, Periscope, talk about binary thinking. I still fall prey to binary thinking. And they can learn from that too. Very true. As long as they learn the right lesson. But sometimes, or a lot of the time, people do learn the wrong lesson. So if someone's trust has been abused, then they might no longer trust anyone else for fear of getting hurt again. Now that's a defense mechanism. And that has to do with one's axiomatic beliefs being destroyed. And so they don't just lose their belief in mankind or humankind, but they lose their belief or their ability to believe in a replacement. That's a whole different topic that we'll talk about at another time. That's sort of like when someone loses their faith in a particular religion. They're not able to easily switch to another religion because they lose faith in religion as a construct itself. It could also guide them towards more trustable people. That's an interesting thing. You know, my uncle always told me, trust people with one eye open. Now, he actually only had one eye. No, I'm kidding. I've said that joke like 3 times. But it's an interesting concept because over time I realized that what that means is that when you trust someone, it's a decision that you make. It has less to do with whether they're trustworthy or not. It has partially something to do with it. If they are looking for trust and partner. Because sometimes what I've noticed is that human beings, I find, say a lot of things that aren't literal. And that's very difficult for me. So most of the time they're saying something. And I've learned now to just not take people seriously for the most part. And I have a couple of guides. And I ask them about important things like, this is what a human did. What's that mean? Is that literal? Is that not literal? Let's go to the next thing here. In life, we establish patterns of behavior, to follow up with what Vincenzo said. And the patterns of behavior can manifest in various circumstances, and changing that course of behavior can be like steering a cargo ship. It can take holding the rudder for quite a while in the other direction. That's important. So that's, for example, if you are shocked out of your version of reality, Jeremiah, where you thought you could trust certain people, now you think, I can't trust anyone. Well, no, what happened was that you were following patterns that you had learned to follow your whole life for whatever reason. Now, someone like myself with autism is conscious of the patterns they're following. So it sort of makes it easier, hello, to talk about it. And to realize that maybe I'm actually transgressing what is actually the correct pattern. And I am following an illusion. And so therefore I have to shift getting used to that old pattern and start to look for a new pattern. But that takes time. It's sort of like learning a new language and unlearning an old language. You can't just say, whoops, English was wrong now that I'm in China. I just have to learn Mandarin. And tomorrow I learn Mandarin. No. Now, there's a joke about that because I have learnt some languages in a few hours. So that was quite funny. Now, by the way, for those who don't know me, that's not an ego statement. Because I did not choose to have that ability. And there are other abilities that I do not have that most people possess. Such as, hello, how are you? Good, thanks, how are you? Yes, I learned that. I did learn that. That was not intuitive until about 27. Now, I'm not actually learning anything with the thesis. I was really frustrated. I'm like, I'm sick of this thesis. I'm not learning anything. But guess what? I'm actually learning how to write a thesis. So that is practical knowledge, which can only be done through implementation. So in other words, empiricism. It's an empirical, it's knowledge that can only be learned empirically. And so there's no exoteric structure to that one. It's completely on the inside. You have to physically do a thesis to know how to do a thesis. Thesis writing is hell. And to say hell is an understatement, because proofreading the thesis that you wrote is a deeper level of hell. It's telling it, it's Dante's Inferno, and it's a deeper level. Because at that level, doesn't lie Satan frozen in some sort of ice. Lies a thesis you have to proofread. Great talk, and see you next time, original. It's a pleasure as always. The theory of writing a thesis. No. Go look on YouTube for those. I'm not doing that again, that's for sure. So the next thing, none of this knowledge would have been with me if I wasn't held hostage in Australia and forced to live these experiences. So that's quite funny. And the point is that I've been stuck here for 6 years over some issues, which I can't talk about yet, but I will be next year. And these issues were devastating and are devastating. And they're very sad for everyone involved, but it forced me to remain here as opposed to being back in the part of the world that I love, being the Mediterranean, my father's homeland, and to help me learn a lot of things, to jump onto Periscope and share them with you, things that I would not have learned myself nor been able to share with you. Now, on a side note, guys, we're going to Bega, 5.5 hours south of Sydney, and that's where it's the famous place they make cheese in Australia. I'm going down there to give our 5th live autism speech on autism. It's going to be awesome. Do I not like living in Australia? That's a hard one. No, I don't. But not because of Australia itself. It has more to do with the very disastrous upbringing I had in this country. Unfortunately, being autistic and an immigrant, I suffered quite a lot of crap. And I don't blame anyone. People didn't know. I don't think people necessarily had bad intentions. I think some people do. Ever been to Europe? I've been to Europe many times. I've been to most parts of the world. Except for the African continent. One day I'd love to Periscope from the African continent and YouTube from the African continent. So, not only do we grow despite bad things happening, we grow because of bad things happening. And there are some elements of growth that require bad things to happen, which is sort of sad, but at the same time, look, things happen, we can't know the future, and so we do. And pass that knowledge on to other people that, fingers crossed, can slightly benefit from that. Doesn't that come to circle to your joy comments earlier? Definitely comes full circle, my friend, and this is how we conclude Wednesday Wisdom today. During the course of conversations, I may say something that can be taken in another way due to my incomplete understanding of social contexts. This is something I'm working on, and so I hope that next time I say something that seems unusually intense or strange, feel free to let me know so that I can then attempt to convey what I actually mean. Now, that statement is something that if you feel that you're a little bit of an outcast or you're on the spectrum, you're going to need that statement. That statement sounds like gibberish, but it makes sense to neurotypicals, and they do give you slightly more leeway. Not everyone, because especially as your actions become more fluid, people start to disbelieve that you have autism. And that's just a testament to how good a job one can do through multiple iterations over many, many years in order to mask the autism at a level enough to be able to negotiate with other members of society. So I'll say it again. Basically, you say during the course of conversations, I may say something that can be taken in another way due to my incomplete understanding of social contexts. This is something I'm working on, and so I hope that next time I say something that seems unusually intense or strange, please feel free to let me know so that I can attempt to convey what I actually mean at that time. And that's Wednesday Wisdom for today, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to see you as always. Love you guys on Periscope. Love you guys on YouTube. Everyone on Periscope, subscribe and like to YouTube. That would be awesome. I do appreciate it. And you can get heaps of other goodies there on YouTube in the autism playlist. Thank you to you guys, Samira and Tony, my Patreons. Love you all. Jeremiah, always a pleasure to see you. And love life. Don't forget, as always, to take life one smack at a time.
Baby, you light up my world like nobody else. The way that you flip your hair gets me overwhelmed. But when you smile at the ground, it ain't hard to tell.